Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Great Anglo-Boer War by Byron Farwell, narrated by Nigel Patterson. Preface. The war is the biggest thing since the mutiny. It is great in itself. It is great in its incidents. It is great in its issues. Lord Lorning, in a letter to Lady Edward Cecil, 11th of December, 1899. Although this book deals with politicians and warriors, with politics and battles, it is neither a military nor a political history in the conventional sense, but a description of a great human drama that encompassed, as Jan Smuts said, a vast tragedy in the life of a people whose human interest far surpassed its military interest. In popular interest, the Anglo-Boer War was eclipsed by the Great War which followed it only a dozen years later, the deaths of millions overshadowing the deaths of mere tens of thousands. But it was an important war, important at the time, and important for its effect on the affairs of the world since. There is little similarity between the Anglo-Boer War and the two world wars. In its early stages, the Second War of Independence, as the Afrikaners now prefer to call the Anglo-Boer War, was reminiscent of the wars of a century earlier, with formal, almost stately, set-piece battles. In its later stages, it more nearly resembled the wars of the last quarter century, those in Southeast Asia, or the wars of the Portuguese in their African colonies. In the two world wars of this century, the actions of individuals or their units could determine the outcome of a battle only when massed with tens or hundreds of thousands of others. Whether the actions of any one man or any one regiment were brave or cowardly, wise or foolish, scarcely mattered except in their aggregate. Battalions and regiments, even divisions, often seemed to lose their identity, to be lost in the swirling mists of battle, disappearing or returning decimated with no noticeable effect on the course of the war. The Anglo-Boer War was different. Although a major war, it was small enough for the actions of individuals and small units to be significant. In September 1899, Britain stood at a point in history and occupied a place in world affairs analogous to that of the United States 60 years later. She was, or conceived herself to be, the greatest power in the world, a belief as yet uncontested and therefore untested. Rulers and statesmen thought, as they are ever prone to do, in terms of conventional national power and of the conventional way in which that power historically had always been tested, through war. Not in 84 years since Waterloo had any major world power seriously contested Britain's position in the world. The Crimean War posed no real threat to the Empire, and the Indian Mutiny, which did, was after all a mutiny and not even a rebellion. But when the Boers invaded Britain's South African colonies in 1899, it marked what is sometimes seen as the beginning of the end of the British Empire, though it certainly did not seem so at the time. The Anglo-Boer War, like the American entanglement in Southeast Asia, involved a highly industrialised nation's attempt to subdue a smaller agricultural country. In both instances, the smaller nations resorted to that form of combat in which the intelligence, imagination and character of the people count most, and the quantity and quality of the weapons least, guerrilla warfare. In both cases, the basic limitations and weaknesses of the great powers were revealed to an envious world, and to its jealous and ambitious rulers and statesmen. Britain won the Great Anglo-Boer War, but at the cost of its reputation. The number of men, the amount of materiel, and the length of time required by mighty Britain to subdue a relative handful of South African farmers jolted Britain and amazed the world. Among the many interested spectators to this revelation of Britain's limitations, none perhaps was more interested than the Kaiser and the great general staff of the German army, which produced a detailed two-volume study of the conflict. The exact extent to which the Kaiser and his generals were influenced by the spectacle of the British army's performance in South Africa cannot be determined, but certainly they saw little to discourage their aggressive ambitions. Whether history has lessons to teach is a debatable and much debated issue, but always men have sought to learn from what others did in the past. As often as not, men have learned the wrong lessons, for like the pronouncements of the oracle at Delphi, the past is capable of many interpretations and is often misunderstood. Men seek solutions to specific problems, and as history never really repeats itself, these kinds of solutions history rarely provides. What it does offer is a vast array of examples which illustrate general principles. A lesson the British thought they had learned from the Anglo-Boer War was the importance of mounted men in modern warfare, and so they sent thousands of horsemen to France in 1914. The real lessons, of course, concerned the more general principles of the importance of mobility to an army. Young W.E. Davies of the Rifle Brigade discovered the kind of lessons history teaches when he found that the Anglo-Boer War was exactly like every other war in that it was unlike any other war. We might, however, learn something from the erroneous conclusions men have drawn from history, particularly the history of wars. After some earlier and all subsequent major wars, there have been those who concluded, as did John Atkins after the Anglo-Boer War, that weapons are too terrible for wars to continue. History has repeatedly illustrated that there is no weapon so terrible that some nation will not sometime use it. The great principles concerning men's conduct are, of course, continually being demonstrated, and the recitation of history's examples, including a roll call of the sins which men and nations are prone to commit, serves as a reminder of the vast range of deeds, good and evil, which men and women are capable of performing. History reminds us, too, that rulers and statesmen are, after all, men and women. For most Britons, the Anglo-Boer War has come to seem quaint. Few remember why it was fought, the way it was fought, or its consequences. The Americans, who had citizens fighting on both sides, who most of them expressed strong pro-Boer sentiments, and who profited mightily from the sale of horses, mules, and tinned beef to the British, remember the war, but none of its details, and they have completely forgotten their own interest and involvement in it. For the Afrikaners, however, the war is still a vital, living issue, though the facts have dissolved into myths, leaving in the hearts of many a distilled bitterness. Although nearly all those who took part in the war are now dead, the fears, hopes, attitudes and prejudices it generated remain, and they influence the actions of the Afrikaner people and the South African government. South Africa is a land in whose history bizarre, improbable events have occurred with astonishing frequency, but no event has left a more lasting imprint on the minds and hearts of her people than the Second Anglo-Boer War, and no one can hope to understand the country or those who today rule it without an understanding of this conflict. The best detailed blow-by-blow account of the war is to be found in The Times History of the War in South Africa, 1899-1902, a seven-volume work written by a variety of hands over several years under the general direction of L.S. Amery. I have made frequent reference to this as simply The Times History. The official history had too many tendentious editors. From the array of conflicting numbers available, casualty figures and sizes of forces engaged, for example, I have tried to select those which seemed to me the most reliable, or at least the most plausible. The best of the modern accounts is Rain Kruger's Goodbye Dolly Gray, first published in 1959. This is a military history, with scant attention paid to the concentration camps and none to the prisoners of war, who by the war's end outnumbered the fighting burghers in the field. Since Kruger's book appeared, a number of studies of men and events connected with the war have been published in South Africa, the works of Johannes Meinkies, for example, and much new material is now available to the historian which throws light on many aspects of the war. And I have received an astonishing amount of unpublished material from helpful and interested South Africans and Englishmen. Finally, it should perhaps be explained that when shrapnel is mentioned, The reference is to the type of shell or its missiles invented by Henry Shrapnel, a projectile timed to explode in the air and to disperse a number of metal pellets, and not, as the word is commonly used by journalists, to describe high explosive shells or their fragments.
Prologue.
1. The birth of a people. South Africa is a land bathed in sunshine, with air so bright and clear that one can see great distances across its unforested hinterland, that vast plateau called the High Veldt. Nature seems to have done its best to protect this fair land from desecration by man. Its few high-banked rivers are unnavigable, and the red soil resists the growth of most alien crops. Behind the High Veldt, for the land seems to face southeast, is the great Kalahari Desert. In front of it lies a series of mountain ranges curving along the escarpment for 1,400 miles, and on the southeastern edge of the plateau, the Karoo, a strip of high, arid tableland. These separate the High Veldt from the Low Veldt and the littoral, which begins in the hot, tropical northeast at Mozambique and sweeps down south to the temperate Cape of Good Hope. South of the Cape, there are only the wastes of Antarctica and the invisible dividing line between the Indian Ocean and the Atlantic. Along South Africa's nearly 2,000 miles of gale-swept coastline, there are few natural harbours, few points at which strangers from the sea can penetrate. Yet men have been here, though never in great numbers, for a very long time, and always they have fought each other. There has been a conflict of cultures here, a race problem, for as long as men can remember. Longer even, for archaeologists and anthropologists have exhumed the problem from the prehistoric past, a past so distant it is not certain the protagonists were actually human. In that dimly seen period of history, hundreds of thousands of years ago, two types of humanoid creatures lived on this land. Then, several thousands of years later, there was but one, Homo sapiens. South Africa's first cultural conflict ended in the complete and utter extermination of one humanoid creature by another. The survivors were perhaps the ancestors of the Bushmen and the Hottentots. These first known inhabitants of the Cape were yellow-skinned people, short in stature, who spoke languages characterized by a number of clicking sounds, which served for some of their consonants. The men had protuberant bellies, the women had pendulous breasts and enormous buttocks. The taller Hottentots developed a more advanced culture and eventually subdued or drove away the Bushmen. In 1498, when Vasco da Gama rounded the Cape and landed at Mossel Bay, he found only Hottentots, at least these are the only people mentioned, for the black men were still far to the north. Other Europeans followed da Gama, but none stayed until on the 6th of April 1652, Johan Jan van Riebeck of the Dutch East India Company landed at Table Bay with about 100 men and 4 women to form a settlement which, it was hoped, would be able to provide meat and fresh vegetables for the company's ships going to and from the East Indies. Van Riebeck built a fort, planted crops, and soon was demanding that more women be sent out. Not soft town-bred girls, but lusty farm wenches. Conflict with the Hottentots was perhaps inevitable. In the unequal struggle, the Europeans soon displayed their superior strength, and the last serious organized resistance of the Hottentots was crushed in 1677. With their easy adaptability, the Hottentots turned from warring against the white man to working for him. Those who survived the white man's diseases began the process of interbreeding with other races that was to result in their extermination as a separate race. In 1688, 36 years after Van Riebeck landed, there arrived at the Cape a group of about 175 Huguenots, men, women and children, who had been driven from France by the revocation of the Edict of Nantes. Within two generations, the French language was forgotten, and the descendants of these refugees merged with the Dutch community, adopting their language, religion, and mode of life, but adding an astonishing number of French surnames, which survive to this day through generations of prolific families. After the Huguenots came a number of German peasants, lured by the offer of free land, and these three nationalities, Dutch, French and German, alloyed to become a new and distinct people called Boers, the word means farmers, or Afrikaners, speaking a variation of 17th century Dutch, known at first as Taal and then as Afrikaans. Later the mixture was enriched by the addition of Britons, mostly Irish and Scots. For a century after the last war with the Hottentots, the colonists experienced a relatively peaceful time, raising cattle and crops, quarrelling with the Dutch officials, moving ever further from government control, seeking ever more land, and breeding themselves into what Conan Doyle called the most rugged, virile, unconquerable race ever seen upon earth. Almost from the beginning, they were discontented with the rule of the Dutch East India Company. In spite of the company's efforts to contain the colony within controllable limits and to curb the wanderlust of its people, the boundaries of the colony expanded, mostly to the northeast, as people moved further and further inland. About the middle of the 18th century, they collided with the blacks in the neighbourhood of the Fish River. The blacks, called Kaffirs until the 20th century, and now Bantu after the type of languages they speak, crossed the northern edge of what is now the Republic of South Africa, perhaps driven south by more warlike tribes in the interior. They remained at first in the rich agricultural lands north of the Kei and Orange Rivers. Later they began to move south between the Drakensberg Range and the Indian Ocean, until eventually, but inevitably, they encountered the advancing whites. Blacks and whites competed for grazing lands and began a sporadic conflict, which was to last for more than a century, until the blacks were beaten into submission and settled down to living and working by the white man's rules. In 1795, when a French-inspired republic replaced the royal government in Holland, the Prince of Orange fled to England and asked the British to take charge of Dutch colonial possessions until he could return to his throne, thus ending the 143-year reign of the Dutch East Africa Company in South Africa. The Afrikaners, like the British government, know better than they had the Dutch. They had, in fact, already developed an almost inbred detestation of any form of government. They continually complained, protested, revolted, and made themselves generally troublesome. In 1802, as one result of the Peace of Amiens, Cape Colony was restored to Holland. But less than 4 years later, in January 1806, a British expeditionary force captured it to keep it out of the hands of the French, and in 1814 it was formally ceded to Britain. This time the British came to stay. But British concepts of justice and humanity conflicted with those of Britain's truculent white South African subjects. From the beginning, her policies were designed to protect what she regarded as the interests of the natives, and to prevent the abuse of slaves and Hottentot servants, who often lived in a state close to slavery. To the Boers, it seemed that their British rulers were unduly interested in the welfare of these people, for the Boers believed in the right of every white man to beat his own nigger, and that the relationship between a master and his servants and slaves was a private, domestic affair of no legitimate concern to the government. In 1813, the British instituted a series of circuit courts to hear the complaints of servants against their masters. This was promptly damned as the Black Court. The Boers were incensed that the word of a slave or servant should carry any weight in a court of law. In 1815, a Boer named Frederick Cornelius Bejaardenhout, who owned a farm on Baviaans River in eastern Cape Colony, ignored the summonses of three circuit courts to appear and answer charges of cruelty to a Hottentot servant. A lieutenant and 12 Hottentot policemen sent to arrest him were fired on as they approached his farm. They returned the fire and Bejaardenhout was killed. This incident was to have repercussions that lasted for well over a century. Eastern Cape Colony was inhabited by tough-minded Boer frontiersmen, accustomed to fighting for what they had and to getting what they wanted. To them it appeared monstrous that the government would send Hottentots to arrest a white man, and even more monstrous that the government would sanction Hottentots killing a white man, and this over a mere matter of a man's treatment of his servant. Bejaardenhout's brother led his neighbours in a hopeless revolt, 60 men against the British Empire. The revolution was soon crushed. 47 men were captured and tried, 30 were sentenced to be banished, and 6 to be executed. One of the 6 was pardoned. The other 5 were publicly hanged at Schlachter's or Schlagter's neck. The executions were, from the British point of view, a simple act of justice. They underestimated or failed to understand their significance for the Boers. Politically, they were a serious blunder. They created martyrs. The Bajaldenhouts and the 5 hanged rebels were enshrined in Boer martyrology, and the hanging at Schlachter's neck is remembered to this day as an example of British repression, brutality, and injustice. The problems of the British rulers multiplied. On the frontiers, there was constant dissatisfaction and unrest, and a series of wars with the Bantu. The rise of the Zulu nation to the north and its expansion into the lands of its neighbours drove tens of thousands of Bantus south, overpopulating the land on the northeastern frontier and increasing the friction between blacks and whites. The British added to the problem by settling some 6,000 Germans there. The Boers complained of too much government and the British settlers of too little. Both grumbled about their insecurity. The garrisons of imperial troops were indeed too small, for the mother country was unwilling to bear the expense of providing soldiers, and the colony could not afford to hire them. Then, too, the British continued their attempts to protect the rights of Hottentots, Bantu, Asians and Coloureds, those of mixed races. British policy regarding these people raised for the Boers the frightening spectre of equality. In 1828, laws were passed which permitted the Hottentots to move about freely without a pass in the land which had once been theirs, and attempts were made to limit what had been the near-absolute authority of their white masters. Then, by Act of Parliament in distant London, the British abolished slavery. Every one of the 39,021 slaves in the colony was to be emancipated by the 1st of December 1834, just at the time of the wheat harvest, noted the Boers bitterly. Compensation was promised, but instead of the more than £3 million expected, only £1,247,401 was provided, payable in London. In South Africa, where the economy was based on slave labour, this spelled ruin for many farmers. The Boers were enraged at this government philanthropy at their expense. Meetings were held, and many determined to flee, whatever the cost. All England's power on land and water will not prevent the emigration of her subjects from her territories, said the Reverend Daniel Lindley. Denys Reitz, himself a Boer, speaking more than a century later, said, "Knowing my countrymen as I do, I think the cause of their leaving was not so much hatred of British rule as dislike of any rule." In the autumn of 1836, advance parties were sent north to scout the land beyond the Karoo, beyond the Orange River, beyond the frontiers of Cape Colony and the reach of the British. There, on the high veldt, the scouts found a vast land, largely depopulated by the tribal wars of the Bantu. In February 1837, the first large body of voortrekkers, as the pioneers were called, moved out of Cape Colony under their leader, Pieter Retief, 1780 to 1838. By September, some 200 Boers had crossed the Orange River. By the end of the year, there were more than 1,000 ox wagons on the high veldt between the Orange and the Vaal rivers. It was the beginning of that mass migration the Boers call the Great Trek. 2. Voortrekkers and their republics. The voortrekkers moved in two directions, north onto the high veldt and northeast into Natal. They travelled at the pace of the ox wagon and their grazing herds, taking with them their families and servants, their guns and their Bibles, their faith in God and in themselves. They quickly became a nomadic, pastoral, self-sufficient people, leading remote and isolated lives, yet united in their common language, religious beliefs, occupations, race, cultural attitudes, and above all else, in their fierce desire for independence, for which they willingly faced savage beasts, lived among primitive men, and suffered all the hardships of a life almost completely divorced from civilized comforts. The Vortrekker Frau gave birth to her young while lying in the wagon's bed or on the bare red sands of the veldt. To survive, a child had to be hardy and strong. It grew up among horses and oxen and wild beasts, the boys learning early to ride, shoot, and manage oxen. The child's world was the great open veldt and the narrow confines of his own family, ruled by its patriarch, who presided over children, grandchildren, daughters-in-law, servants, and slaves. His home was the sturdy ox wagon, and there were no schools. From itinerant predikants, ministers of the Dutch Reformed Church, and from relatives, the child tried to learn to read the Bible in Dutch. There was no other literature available, wanted, or even tolerated, so that children grew up suspicious of all beyond their own narrow culture. Early in life, they developed into strong men and tough-fibred women. Wherever they went, the Boers established republics. A quarrelsome, contumacious people, they argued endlessly among themselves about where to settle, about religion, there were degrees of Calvinistic strictness, and about who their leaders should be. When feelings ran too high, the dissidents took to their horses and ox wagons and moved on to found other republics elsewhere. The little republic founded at Winburg, the first important settlement north of the Orange, split four ways. The Trek estates often took their names from the districts or towns, usually mere villages, which they made their capitals: Potchefstroom, Leidenburg, Zoutpansberg, and Winburg. But some had more colourful names, such as Stellaland, Goshen, and New Republic. All of these either were annexed by the British or were absorbed into the two large republics which eventually emerged. The Trekker republics had certain features in common: the use of Roman Dutch law, a state church, a white male franchise, the obligation of every man and boy over 15 to turn out with his horse, wagon, and provisions to fight a common enemy, and, most important of all, an all-powerful legislative body called a Volksraad. The chief officials were the president and the commandant general. Each district had a landdrost, magistrate, a commandant who led the district's commando in time of war, and a veldtcornet, field cornet, who served as an administrator for both the landdrost and the commandant. All were elected. Even in war, most of the major decisions were made not by the commandant alone, but by a Kriegsraad, council of war, which was usually attended by everybody in the commando. It was almost true, as was said, that every Boer was a general. When Piet Retief led his people out of Cape Colony, he took them to Natal, where in February 1838 he concluded an agreement with Dingaan, king of the Zulus, giving him and his Vortrekkers a large tract of land between the Umzimvubu and Tugela rivers. No sooner was the agreement signed, however, than Dingaan called out his warriors, killed Retief and those with him, and sent his impis to attack Boer lagers scattered throughout Natal. Of the 3,500 Vortrekkers there, at least 350 men, women, and children fell under the slashing, stabbing assegais of the Zulus. Retief's place as Trek leader was taken by Andries Pretorius, 1798-1853, who at once assembled a 500-man commando to fight the Zulus. It was a handful against a horde, but it was ever characteristic of the Boers to be disdainful of numerically superior enemies and to put their faith in their own fighting capabilities and in God. And when the Boers put their trust in God, they expected his active cooperation and support. No Christian people in modern times have so firmly and wholeheartedly believed in the righteousness of their causes and so confidently relied on God's support. To move into the vicinity of the enemy, take up a good defensive position and wait to be attacked, was a characteristic Boer tactic. In a vast land where occupation of ground was strategically unimportant and where the enemy invariably possessed superiority in numbers, this was sound military doctrine, for attackers generally suffer greater losses than defenders. This was the tactic used by Pretorius. He led his commando into Zululand and beside the Blood River formed a strong lager, ox wagons in a circle prepared for defence. And there, on the 16th of December 1838, the Zulus found them and launched a savage, unsuccessful attack. Unable to close with their enemy, a tactic imposed on them by the short assegai, they fell before the flintlocks of the Boers. It is said that 3,000 Zulus were killed at a cost to the Boers of 3 wounded. The number of Zulus killed is doubtless an exaggeration, but certainly the Boers attained a remarkable victory. It is still remembered, for the 16th of December became Dingaan's Day, now called Day of the Covenant, in keeping with the oath of perpetual remembrance taken by Pretorius and his men. And each year it is celebrated by Afrikaners as a proud day of solemn thanksgiving. A year after Pretorius's victory, the Four Trekkers raised their own flag at Durban, but their fragile republic, Natalia, was not allowed to grow. In 1842, a British force under that redoubtable old warrior Sir Harry Smith, 1787 to 1860, hero of the First Sikh War, occupied Durban, dismantled the Republic, raised the Union Jack, and 3 years later formally annexed Natal to the British Empire. It was to become the most British of all the South African colonies, for the Boers left, carrying with them an abiding sense of injury and injustice, a bitter hatred of the British who had robbed them of their land for which they had fought and bled. The Boers from Natal joined those from the Cape in climbing onto the high veldt, and 10 years after the start of the Great Trek, there were perhaps 15,000 Boers there. Most stayed in the land lying between the Orange and Vaal rivers, but some trekked on ever northward, beyond the Vaal and up into the wild Zoutpansberg. Soon the whole area between the Orange and the Limpopo, 160,000 square miles, was sprinkled with Trekker republics. The British could not quite decide what, if anything, they should do about these people. They did not like the idea of Boer republics on the flanks of Natal and Cape Colony. Missionaries continually protested against the enslavement of the natives by the Boers and demanded that Britain exercise its power to bring British justice onto the high veldt. On the other hand, most politicians in London quailed at the expense and difficulty of attempting to administer these vast, sparsely populated lands, inhabited by such troublesome people. Wavering British attitudes were reflected in wavering British policies over a long period. In 1847, Sir Harry Smith became governor of Cape Colony and claimed authority over the land between the Orange and Vaal rivers. The Boers there, led by Pretorius, took up arms to defend their independence, but Sir Harry crossed the Orange with a mixed force of regulars, colonials and Griquas, and defeated them at Boomplatz. 3 years later, the land was formally annexed as the Orange River Territory. The Boers could set up all the republics they chose, but they could never really consider themselves free until and unless the British ceased to consider them British subjects and agreed not to interfere with them. Actually, as they eventually learned, they would not be safe even then. However, the Four Trekkers in the three republics beyond the Vaal, Potchefstroom, Zoutpansberg and Leidenburg, having at last trekked far away enough from all British authority, did manage to achieve formal recognition of their independence. In January 1852, Boers and Britons met at the Zant River and signed a document which became known as the Zant River Convention. The meeting appears to have been somewhat haphazard. Not all the Boers were represented. The authority of the British commissioners was vague, and the document itself was informal, being entitled Minutes of a Meeting Between Her Majesty's Assistant Commissioners and a deputation of emigrant farmers residing north of the Vaal River. There were a number of clauses about facilitating trade, extradition of criminals, and free movement across the frontier, but the meat of the document was the agreement on the part of the Boers to prohibit slavery and the promise of the British not to interfere with their internal affairs. The British thus gave up all claim to the area between the Vaal and the Limpopo rivers. In February 1854, another Anglo-Boer agreement was signed. The Bloemfontein Convention gave independence to the inhabitants of the land between the Orange and the Vaal. The Zant River Convention had promised not to impose British rule. The Bloemfontein Convention promised to withdraw the existing British authority, to abandon all responsibility, not only for the Boers, but for the 40,000 Bantu, mostly Basutos, and Coloureds who lived there. The actual withdrawal took place without celebration or ceremony, when the 300 men of the garrison at Bloemfontein marched south and crossed the Orange into Cape Colony. It would be nearly half a century before British troops recrossed that boundary. The new Orange Free State, as the Orange River Territory became, went through three presidents in the first 10 years of its existence. Then, in 1864, Johannes Hendrikus Brandt, 1823-1888, was elected president, and for 24 years he wisely guided the infant republic's destiny. Although he often nettled the British, he was careful never to give them cause to meddle. This was not easy. The aggressive and powerful British resented the very presence of the two republics, and the Free Staters had to tread warily, even in the face of such wrath-provoking British arrogance as the annexation of the Diamond Fields in 1872, an action which left a bitter taste in the mouths of the Free Staters and confirmed their traditional distrust of Great Britain. It is not surprising, then, that not long after, they were quick to see in the high-handed actions of the British in the Transvaal a threat to their cherished independence. The Transvaal had not been as fortunate in its leadership and had fallen into a chaotic state. Burghers refused to pay taxes, government debts mounted, there was no money for schools, roads or public buildings. The Volksraad argued and quarrelled and accomplished nothing. By 1877, the Bapedi, a hostile tribe, were causing trouble on the southeastern frontier, and Zulu impis were poised for an invasion. Although slavery was forbidden, a law designed to provide for orphans permitted a system of apprenticeship that was very close to it. Every successful commando returned with orphans, and questions were seldom asked about the parents when a Boer registered apprentices. Once indentured, the children could be sold, and there was a considerable trade in them. At least once, a wagon load of black orphans was openly sold in the streets of Potchefstroom. The British thought it was perhaps time to take under its imperial wing this immoral, bankrupt country, drifting towards anarchy and war. They sent Theophilus Shepstone, 1817-1893, to investigate and, if necessary, to act. He arrived in Pretoria, capital of the Transvaal, on the 22nd of January 1877, with a small staff which included the 21-year-old future novelist H. Rider Haggard and an escort of 25 mounted policemen. Many of the people with whom he spoke favoured annexation, and he thought the conditions of the country seemed to justify this action. Haggard said, "Anything more hopeless than the position of the country on the 1st of January 1877, it is impossible to conceive. Enemies surrounded it. In the Exchequer there was nothing but overdue bills. The President was helpless and mistrustful of his officers. All the ordinary functions of government had ceased, and trade was paralysed. The majority of the inhabitants, who would neither fight nor pay taxes, sat still and awaited the catastrophe, utterly careless of all consequences." In the Victorian era, a curious belief was prevalent that sovereign states ought to have governments that were reasonably efficient and solvent. It was true that some of the burghers were apathetic. Others saw annexation as the only solution to the government's woes, and probably a few even believed Shepstone's assurances that annexation would be a blessing and that Britain's motives were entirely philanthropic. But there was a sizeable number, a majority as it turned out later, who, although disliking their own government, liked the idea of British rule even less. This view was forcefully expressed by the Volksraad, which stated its strong objections. Britain ignored these, as it ignored also the provisions of the Sand River Convention, although a case could be made that the Transvaal had violated the convention by permitting conditions very near slavery to exist. In April 1877, the Transvaal was annexed, and Shepstone became the first British governor. Although he promised at the outset the fullest legislative privileges compatible with the circumstances of the country and the intelligence of the people, no elected legislative body was ever assembled, and the Boers were left with no effective voice in their government. There was some talk of armed rebellion and much grumbling. Former Vice President Paul Kruger even made two trips to London, once with a petition signed by a majority of the male population, protesting the annexation and begging for independence. Nothing came of it. Less than 2 years after the annexation of the Transvaal, the British went to war with the Zulus, crossing the Buffalo River and invading Zululand at three points. The results were disastrous. Near a hill called Isandwana, the Zulus fell upon a large part of the main column and almost completely exterminated it. Nearly 900 men were left dead amidst a welter of broken wagons and scattered supplies. Only a few days after the start of the invasion, what was left of the British army came limping back across the Buffalo. Britain was appalled. That black savages armed with assegais could defeat a large force of British regulars armed with modern rifles and artillery seemed incredible. The Boers in the Transvaal raised their eyebrows. They remembered how Pretorius, with a handful of men armed with muskets, had beat off Dingaan's impis. The famed British army was not, after all, invincible, even against savages. Although the British rushed reinforcements to Natal and the Zulus were eventually crushed, the defeat at Isandwana made a lasting impression on the Transvaalers. When the news of this British disaster reached London, the government sent out Sir Garnet Wolseley, the most brilliant general of the Victorian era. He was appointed High Commissioner for South Africa, and although the Zulu War was finished before he arrived, he undertook a campaign that crushed the troublesome Bapedi. Wolseley was soon made aware of Boer discontent, but he was contemptuous of it. Ignorant men, led by a few designing fellows, are talking nonsense on the high veldt, he said. He advised the Boers to forget about independence, for so long as the sun shines, the Transvaal will remain British territory. But in a dispatch home on the 29th of October 1879, he warned that the main body of the Dutch population are disaffected to our rule. The Transvaalers continued to hope, and with some reason, that the British would change their minds. No one had been louder in his denunciations of the annexation than William Ewart Gladstone, who had called it a hideous and treacherous crime. His speeches, together with those of political leaders who agreed with him, were given much space in Transvaal newspapers, and some of the speeches were published as pamphlets. When, in the spring of 1880, Gladstone became Prime Minister, they waited expectantly for their independence to be restored, a hope finally dashed by Gladstone himself when he informed them, "Looking at all the circumstances, our judgment is that the Queen cannot be advised to relinquish the Transvaal." The Boers digested this information for 6 months and then rose in revolt. 3. The First Anglo-Boer War. No one dreamed that the Boers in the Transvaal would fight. The British officials there did not think so, the colonials in Natal and Cape Colony did not think so, and certainly no one in London thought they would be so rash. There were, indeed, sound reasons for holding such a belief. The Boers had, after all, quietly accepted the annexation only 3 years earlier. They were widely scattered and armed only with hunting weapons, and they were uneducated, many illiterate. And consider the audacity of the thing. For some 50,000 people, less than half the population of Kensington or of Peoria, Illinois, spread over more than 110,000 square miles, to challenge the might of the British Empire with its hundreds of millions of people, its army alone more than three times larger than the entire white population of the Transvaal, its navy twice the size of any other and undisputed master of all the oceans and seas. No, it was unthinkable. But the British underestimated the depth and extent of Boer discontent. Only a spark was needed to ignite the flame of revolt, and Piet Bejaardenhout, believed to be a descendant of the Bejaardenhouts who started the revolt at Schlachter's Neck in 1815, provided the spark. It began simply enough when he refused to pay his taxes, a common enough thing among the Boers. The government sued him for £27.5, but Bejaardenhout pointed out that this was £14 more than he owed. The court agreed, reduced the tax due, and assessed him £13.5 court costs. When he balked at this, his ox wagon was seized. The stoutly built, half-tented ox wagon was to the Boer more than just a farm wagon. Often it was the family's most valuable and valued possession, and frequently their home as well. In native wars, it was a movable fort from which a man could defend himself. Efficient and economical, it made the Trek Boer's lifestyle possible, and he usually had an attachment to it in excess of its material value. With it and 6 to 8 span of oxen, the vast spaces of the open veldt were his, for he had no need of roads. To lose an ox wagon was a serious matter. That the government would seize one for a mere £13.5 debt was, felt most Boers, rank injustice. Piet Bejaardenhout's ox wagon was scheduled to be sold in the public square of Potchefstroom at 11 a.m. on the 11th of November 1880. Early that morning, some 100 Boers assembled in front of the Landdrost's office to protest. Indignant speeches were made, and having stirred themselves up, they moved on to the public square. When an official mounted the wagon to read the conditions of sale, Piet Cronier dragged him off and kicked him. Oxen were brought up, and the wagon was triumphantly hauled back to the Bejaardenhout farm. 140 Scots fusiliers and 2 guns were sent to restore order and to enforce the government's authority. Marching out to meet Cronier, they found him on his farm surrounded by thoroughly aroused armed Boers. The fusiliers prudently withdrew to Potchefstroom and settled themselves to wait for tempers to cool, throwing up some earthworks and making a little fort just outside the town. But the British underestimated the fighting fever of Cronier and his men. In the early afternoon of the 15th of December, some 500 of them, led by Cronier, rode into Potchefstroom and occupied its principal buildings and streets. The troops and some of the townspeople retreated to the fort. The following day, a small party of Boers trotted defiantly out towards the fort. One called out, "Why don't you fight, you damned cowards?" When a lieutenant and 13 men sent out to drive them away rode purposefully towards them, they wheeled their ponies and dashed for town, the troopers on their heels. At the edge of town, 4 or 5 Boers raised their rifles and fired. The troops returned the fire, and Commandant Franz Roberts was hit in the arm. The war had begun. In December 1880, nearly 5,000 men, women and children gathered at Pardekraal, a farm near present-day Krugersdorp, and proclaimed themselves to be free in a long manifesto which said in part, "We therefore make it known to everybody that on the 13th of December 1880 the government has been re-established. Mr. S. J. P. Kruger has been appointed vice-president and shall form with Mr. M. W. Pretorius and Mr. P. Hubert a triumvirate that shall execute the government of the country. The Volksrat has recommenced its sitting." Before the day was over, every person there found a stone and placed it on a symbolic heap, pledging themselves to the task of regaining their independence. They declared Heidelberg to be their temporary capital, and there, on the 16th of December, Dingaan's Day, the Boers always attached importance to historic dates, the long declaration of independence was read, and the four-coloured flag, the Transvaal Vierkleur, was hoisted in defiance. In Pretoria, rifles were handed out from the back of a wagon to everyone who looked as if he could shoot one. The Transvaalers' hopes and dreams were set forth in a petition of rights that they sent to the government of the Orange Free State in the hope of enlisting their support. It listed their grievances in great detail, ending with confidence we lay our case before the whole world, be it that we conquer or that we die. Liberty shall arise in Africa as the sun from the morning clouds, as liberty rose in the United States of North America. Then will it be from the Zambezi to Simon's Bay, Africa for the Afrikaner. The British were unperturbed. At Leidenburg, young Elsa Dietrich warned Lieutenant Colonel Philip Robert Anstruther of the 94th Foot that the Boers were plotting rebellion and that the British were not safe. Anstruther laughed. "Do you think, Miss Dietrich, that the British army is asleep?" She might have answered in all truth, yes. The British army was completely unprepared. The forces in the Transvaal at the beginning of the revolution were certainly inadequate, and they were split into tiny garrisons sprinkled about the country. A few days later, Anstruther knew beyond any doubt that Miss Dietrich had spoken the truth. Marching with a column of 250 men and 3 women, he reached Bronkhorstspruit, about 38 miles east of Pretoria, his destination, on the 20th of December. The band was playing, and he was marching across Mr. Grobler's farm when a horseman carrying a white flag dashed up and handed him a message, a demand for immediate surrender. Anstruther refused, and the Boers opened fire, shooting from concealed positions. Before the soldiers could shake out of their marching formation into skirmishing order, the battle was over. 56 soldiers and 1 of the women were killed. 101 were wounded, of whom 20 later died. Only 1 officer survived, and he was badly wounded. As soon as the firing ceased, the Boers came forward to help. Tents were set up, and the battlefield became a hospital. Farmer Grobler supplied what he could, bread, butter, and fruit. From Pretoria came doctors and a stream of townspeople bringing food and books and other comforts. One of the doctors was amazed at the number of multiple wounds the soldiers had suffered, stating that there were, on an average, 5 wounds per man. An exaggeration, perhaps, but the Boers were among the finest marksmen in the world. The dead soldiers were buried on Mr. Grobler's farm, and it is said that from the seeds of peaches in their knapsacks sprang flourishing peach trees. It was more than a month before another pitched battle was fought, although throughout the Transvaal the British were besieged in all their little garrisons by Boer commandos that simply sat down around them to starve them out. In Natal, the British were hurriedly throwing together an army to rescue the besieged garrisons and to restore the authority of the Crown. In command was Major General Sir George Colley, 45 years old, and considered by many to be the brightest intellect in the British Army, but he was apprehensive about his performance, for this was his first independent command. In a letter home, he wrote, "Whether I shall find that South Africa is to me, as it is said to be in general, the grave of all good reputations, remains to be seen." His opponent was Petrus Piet Jacobus Huber, the 46-year-old Commandant General of the Transvaal Boers. He had fought in native wars, but he lacked the temperament, training and inclination to be a soldier. He was a farmer politician, a man who disliked war. The Boers seized the initiative, not waiting for the British to invade. Some 2,000 crossed the frontier into Natal and took up favourable positions at Lang's Neck, Langeneck. There, on the 23rd of January 1881, Colley found them and ordered them to disperse. The Boers showed a disposition to bargain, but not to be cowed. They replied, "We declare that we would be satisfied with the rescinding of the annexation and the restoration of the South African Republic under a protectorate of Her Majesty the Queen, so that once a year the British flag shall be hoisted. If Your Excellency resolves to reject this, we have only to submit to our fate, but the Lord will provide." The Lord provided. In a short, simple battle, the British soldiers charged and the Boers shot them down. There were 195 British casualties. In this battle, the 58th Regiment carried its colours into battle. It was the last British regiment ever to do so. Huber failed to follow up his victory, and 10 days later Colley had recovered sufficiently to make an effort to clear his line of communication and meet and escort some wagons expected from Newcastle. He set out on the 8th of February, a fine and bright morning, with 273 infantry, 38 mounted men, and 4 guns. Thomas Fortescue Carter, a newspaper correspondent who accompanied the expedition, noted that everyone was in good spirits at the prospect of an outing. Colley did not expect to be attacked. He thought his guns would deter the enemy, who had no artillery of their own. But about noon, at Swans Hoogte, near the Ingogo River, the Boers opened fire on the column. The battle lasted all afternoon. About 5 o'clock, rain began to fall, and the British huddled on a piece of rising ground while the Boers lay back and picked them off. At dusk, some British reinforcements arrived, but they were too late. 7 officers and 69 men were killed, and 3 officers and 64 men wounded. Under cover of darkness, Colley retreated, leaving most of his wounded lying in the rain. The British suffered defeat in 3 successive engagements, but they were small affairs. No decisive battle had yet been fought. As the 2 armies sat facing each other on the Natal-Transvaal border, Colley made a careful study of the Boer position. It was located below a steep, high hill, an extinct volcano, actually, called Majuba or Amajuba, which did not appear to be held. It was the key topographical feature, and Colley saw that if he occupied it, he could prise the Boers out of their positions. On the night of the 26th of February, orders were quietly passed for 494 soldiers and 64 sailors to assemble, with arms, ammunition, greatcoats, entrenching tools, and 3 days' rations. Including the medical staff, some Bantu porters, and 3 newspaper correspondents, there were about 600 men. At 10 o'clock on this moonless night, Colley led his force towards Majuba. As they passed near the farm of R.C. O'Neill, a dog barked, but the silent men marched on, and the dog roused no one. On a ridge at the base of the hill, 2 companies were detached and ordered to entrench. The horses of the officers were also left, and the troops began the long, hard climb to the summit. In old age, Ian Hamilton, then a lieutenant in the Gordon Highlanders, wrote, "I remember as if it were yesterday the tense excitement of that climb up with a 6 shadowy forms close by, which were swallowed up and disappeared if they got further away from me than 6 paces." It was 3 o'clock in the morning before they reached the top, exhausted but exultant. Many men, weighed down by their 58 pounds of equipment and provisions, had lagged behind and in the dark had lost contact with their own units. Straggling in, they were sent to positions that seemed short of men. Thus the units were not well organised under their own officers, and no attempt was made to sort them out. They could now rest for a few hours, but most were too excited to sleep, and besides, it was cold in the early morning hours. The top of Majuba was about 400 yards long and 300 yards wide, and in the centre was a basin-like depression. No effort was made to entrench or to throw up any effective defences. Neither was the position properly reconnoitred, for some men were posted to defend a side that was quite adequately protected by a sheer precipice. Dawn revealed the Boer lager below them. Looking down from our position right into the enemy's lines, we seemed to hold them in the palm of our hands, said Thomas Carter, one of the correspondents. Colley looked around and remarked, "We could stay here forever." Highlanders stood up and gleefully shook their fists. One called out, "Come up here, you beggars!" Down in the Boer lager, it was Hendrina Hubert, wife of the Commandant General, who first saw the British on Majuba. Hendrina always accompanied her husband on commando, and it was said that she was the soldier in the family. She had slept badly, and at first light had got up, dressed, and gone out of the tent to put a kettle on the fire. Looking up at Majuba, she saw Colley's men on the rim, and ran to rouse her husband. "Pete, come here. There are people on the kop." Hubert sounded the alarm and the lager sprang to life. Nicolas Smith, one of the bravest and best of the Boer generals, called for volunteers to climb Majuba. Lieutenant Ian Hamilton, in charge of an advanced picket outside the basin, saw the first of the volunteers beginning to climb, and he hastened to report to Colley. The general thanked him politely for his information and sent him back. 3 times more that morning Hamilton reported the progress of the advancing Boers. The last time he found Colley asleep. There was a small detached knoll on the east side where Hamilton was stationed, and some of the first Boers to come within rifle range occupied this, pouring a heavy fire into his position. Hamilton was forced to retreat. The Boers gained the rim of the basin. Once more Hamilton dashed back to Colley, now awake, and petitioned him, "I do hope, General, that you will let us have a charge, and that you will not think it presumption on my part to have come up and asked you. No presumption, Mr. Hamilton, but we will wait until the Boers advance on us, then give them a volley and charge. Minutes later, Colley fell dead, a bullet through his head. The Boers were overrunning the British position. Back with his men, Hamilton seized a rifle, but before he could raise it, a bullet shattered his left wrist. Everywhere the soldiers fled from the Boers. The commands and threats of their officers did nothing to arrest the headlong flight.
"I'll shoot you if you don't come back," one officer shouted,
but the men ran blindly on. The newspaper men ran too. Thomas Carter found himself racing shoulder to shoulder with a stalwart Highlander. Directly in front of them was the hospital area with the wounded men stretched out on the ground. They swerved around the wounded, and Carter, aware that the Highlander had the inside track, begrudged him the advantage. All around them, running men pitched forward as the Boers poured a murderous fire into their backs. Carter heard one cry, "Oh my God!" as he fell. He leapt over him and pounded on. At the edge of the rim, Carter and the others were forced to pull up. A 40-foot cliff fell away before them. A bullet from the rear toppled one of the men near him, and Carter, fearing a broken neck less than a bullet in the back, dropped to his stomach and launched himself over the side. Clutching at the tufts of heather, he managed to break his fall and land unhurt at the bottom. He and those who followed his example found themselves in a ravine. They tried to run down it, but the Boers were soon above them, sending down a shower of bullets that impinged off the rocks around them. All were forced to surrender. Carter, like the other correspondents, carried a pistol, but he thought it would look better if he was found unarmed, and he managed to bury his revolver in the sand before he gave himself up. Among the Boers' prisoners was Lieutenant Alan Hill of the 58th Foot, who only a month earlier had won the Victoria Cross for rescuing two wounded men under heavy fire at Lang's Neck. Now he was holding a bloody arm, ripped open from the elbow to the wrist. In the general rout, Ian Hamilton also fled, clutching his shattered wrist. Then a spent bullet or chip of rock struck him on the head and he fell unconscious. When he recovered, two boys of about 14 were turning him over and removing his sword and equipment. They were chased off by an old Boer with a black beard, and when he was on his feet, Hamilton was led to identify Colley's body. J.H.J. Vessels, one of his captors, attended to Hamilton's wound, binding his wrist with an improvised splint made from the top of a bully beef tin and tying it with his own red bandana. 30 years later, Lieutenant General Sir Ian Hamilton again met Mr. Vessels and presented him with a new handkerchief in a silver box. Hamilton was allowed to wander about, and for a while he carried water to the wounded. He heard one Boer, looking at the shambles around him, piously declare that such was the fate of those who chose to fight on the Sabbath. About dusk, he slipped away, tried to climb down the hill and make his way back to camp, but darkness fell, there was a heavy rain, and he lost his way. Exhausted and in pain, he sank down and lost consciousness. A dog's tongue licking his face roused him. Patch, his fox terrier, had come out with a search party and had found his master. Hamilton's arm was forever crippled, but at the age of 91 he could still say, "Majuba was worth an arm any day." Majuba was the last battle of the war. General Evelyn Wood, who now took command of the British forces in South Africa, was ordered to arrange an armistice. The British wanted peace. The Transvaal did not seem important enough to shed blood over it. Majuba, although a small affair, was particularly mortifying for Britain. Never before in its long history had British arms suffered such a humiliating defeat. A group of unsoldierly farm boys had completely routed a British force containing elements of the Royal Navy and regulars from some of the most famous regiments in the British Army, and a force, moreover, that was 6 times larger than that of the Boers, and in what ought to have been an impregnable position. A royal commission was appointed to go to Pretoria to treat with the Boers, and on the 3rd of August 1881 the Pretoria Convention, as the peace terms were called, was signed and published. It gave the Transvaalers complete self-government, subject to suzerainty of Her Majesty. Britain retained control over external relations, the right to move troops through the country, and a veto over laws affecting the Bantu. The Transvaalers agreed to permit foreigners to enter, live, and work in the country without interference, and to exempt from military service British subjects registered with the British resident. What the Transvaal Boers had been unable to accomplish with argument, they had achieved with bullets, and their bravery, determination, and sheer audacity. In England, reaction to the Pretoria Convention was mixed. Some regarded it as a generous gesture on the part of Gladstone's government, but most saw it as a shameful capitulation. Conan Doyle said, "It was the height of idealism, and the result has not been such as to encourage its repetition. The Boers saw neither generosity nor humanity in our conduct, but only fear." Queen Victoria warned her ministers that there would be disastrous results from such a humiliating peace made on the heels of military defeat. The army was thoroughly outraged. Lieutenant Colonel Hugh McElmont of the 7th Hussars expressed a common feeling when he wrote in a letter home, "Why have Collie and all his men been sacrificed if there was a foregone conclusion of the government that there was nothing worth fighting about?" The British inhabitants of South Africa were dismayed. In the market square of Newcastle, Natal, there was raving, weeping, and blaspheming. In Pretoria, loyalists folded a Union Jack in a coffin and held a bitter funeral. C.K. White, president of the Committee of Loyal Inhabitants of the Transvaal, spoke of men crying like children. He sent letters protesting the peace to Gladstone, Lord Kimberley, and the House of Commons, together with a petition signed by 34 loyalists. "Unless the supremacy of England be vindicated," it declared, "inhabitants of British descent living in South Africa will be subjected to continual insult and injury, not only from the Boers, but also from native tribes who have witnessed our defeat and humiliation." In reply, Gladstone blandly stated that it had been thought that the Transvaalers wanted British rule, but now it was clear they did not, and "Her Majesty's government have thought it their duty to avail themselves of the earliest indications on the part of the Boers of a disposition to a reasonable adjustment, in order to terminate a war which threatened the most disastrous consequences, not only to the Transvaal, but to the whole of South Africa." The First Anglo-Boer War created only a brief sensation in the world outside South Africa. There were too many other dramatic events following close on the heels of the armistice in 1881. On the 12th of March, the French occupied Tunis. The next day, Alexander II, Tsar of Russia, was assassinated. Disraeli died on the 12th of April, and on the 2nd of July, James Garfield, newly inaugurated President of the United States, was shot. 3 years after the war, under the terms of the London Convention, the British gave up the right to march troops through the Transvaal, and the right to any control over the treatment of the Bantu. Paul Kruger was now president of the new republic, which officially called itself the Republic of South Africa, and at his insistence there was no mention of British suzerainty in the London Convention. Majuba Day was already enshrined as a memorable date among the Boers, but it was evidently a much less significant date for the British, for the London Convention was signed on the 27th of February 1881, the third anniversary of Britain's humiliating defeat. The Boers were now relatively content. The British had removed the menace of the Zulus and the Bapedi, introduced some order into the government, and returned the government to them. A president and Volksraad had been elected, and all the trappings of a Trekker Republic were restored. So things might have remained, and perhaps Boer and Britain would have learned to live side by side, had not a disaster struck the Transvaal. Gold was discovered on the Witwatersrand. 4. The Jameson Raid. The Rand, short for the Witwatersrand, meaning Ridge of White Water, is a 60-mile-long ridge running roughly east and west, its centre about 30 miles south of Pretoria. It was and is the largest gold field in the world. The uncovering of its buried riches solved the financial difficulties of the South African Republic, but it created tragic problems of its own, and no one foresaw this more clearly than President Paul Kruger, who told his countrymen in a prophetic statement, "Instead of rejoicing, you would do better to weep, for this gold will cause our country to be soaked in blood." When the gold of the Rand was discovered in 1887, a flood of foreigners, outlanders, the Boers called them, poured into the country. These gold seekers, many of them footloose adventurers, were a different breed of men from the farmers and small tradesmen who had previously been drawn to the Transvaal, and the government was ill-prepared to cope with them. Less than 15% were married men who had brought their families with them and intended to settle. The rest were either single or men who had left their families in their home countries and intended to go back as soon as they had made their fortunes. They congregated in and around Johannesburg, where John Merriman, a Cape politician, described them as a loafing, drinking, scheming lot, who would, he said, corrupt an archangel, or at any rate knock a good deal of bloom off its wings. The Transvaal government tried to be helpful, but the size of the outlander population increased so rapidly that it was frightening. They were fast outnumbering the Boers themselves, and they made little or no effort to settle into Boer ways. They were, in fact, strident in their demands for concessions, changes in the laws, even, as they were the most heavily taxed, the right to vote. Most of all, they wanted things done the right way, their way. Although most of the outlanders were of British origin, there were representatives from the United States, Australia, and every country in Europe. Miners, prospectors, and speculators poured in, and behind them came gamblers, businessmen, thieves, financiers, prostitutes, and engineers. There were adventurers of all classes, all eager to make a fortune, all greedy. Some were poor, and some were rich already but wanted more. Some were stupid, and a few were very clever indeed. Among the rich and the clever was Cecil Rhodes, 1853 to 1902, who had already made a fortune from diamonds at Kimberley, and who in a remarkably short period of time had become the richest man in the Western world. In 1890, at the age of 37, he became Prime Minister of Cape Colony as well. Rhodes was a man of big dreams, one of which was a united South Africa, united under the Union Jack, and of a British Africa extending from the Cape to Cairo. In 1895, he thought he saw in the complaints of the outlanders an opportunity for Britain to re-annex the Transvaal. The Boers, too, had a vision of a united South Africa, but of an Afrikaner state under a Republican flag. In the course of events, the dreams of both were realised, but for neither Boer nor Briton was 1895 the right time. Within the Transvaal government, there were undoubtedly inefficiencies and some corruption, but the causes of the outlanders' discontent were annoyances, not oppressions. Conan Doyle's contention that their whole lives were darkened by injustice was a gross exaggeration. Their grievances were certainly not adequate excuses for rebellion. Yet there was violent talk, and in Johannesburg a 66-man reform committee made seditious noises. Rhodes encouraged them. When they determined to revolt, he supplied them with arms, smuggling rifles and ammunition into the country in coal wagons and oil drums of the De Beers Company, which he controlled. Just over the Transvaal frontier nearest Johannesburg, Rhodes stationed a force of some 500 armed and mounted men, with instructions to wait until the revolt on the Rand began, and then ride in and assure its success. In charge of this operation was Dr. Leander Starr Jamieson, 1853-1917, Rhodes's friend, employee, confidant, and sharer of his dreams of empire and glory. The conspiracy was not very secret. Everyone in Johannesburg knew about it, and naturally Kruger knew too. Sir Hercules Robinson, the British High Commissioner in Cape Town, and Joseph Chamberlain, the Colonial Secretary in London, also knew about it, although they tried to avoid knowing and persisted in pretending that they did not know. When Sir Hercules' Imperial Secretary tried to tell him more, he snapped, "The less you and I have to do with these damned conspiracies of Rhodes and Chamberlain, the better." What no one knew, not even the conspirators themselves, was the date. Several dates were fixed, but each time the event was postponed. The plotters were not professional revolutionaries or even politicians. For the most part, they were prospering businessmen and well-paid workmen. Rhodes's brother, Colonel Frank Rhodes, a British army officer then in the Transvaal, wrote on the 25th of October 1895 that so long as people are making money individually in Johannesburg, they will endure a great many political wrongs. Many of the Outlanders would have preferred to see a reformed Transvaal government rather than British annexation. They disliked Britain's native policy and the meddling of Parliament and the philanthropic societies, for the Outlanders' view of the position of non-whites in society was little different from that of the Boers. The Americans, of whom there were a goodly number, including 8 on the Reform Committee, were almost unanimous in rejecting the idea of British rule, and many refused to participate when they learned that it was intended to hoist the Union Jack. There was much bickering and vacillation. Rhodes was growing impatient, and Jameson, in whom patience was never a plentiful commodity, was growing more so. But old Paul Kruer, Uncle Paul, his people called him, was patient, and he counselled patience to his burghers. "Take a tortoise," he told them. "If you want to kill it, you must wait until it puts out its head, and then you cut it off." Jameson, with his troopers, sat on the border in the dusty little village of Pitsani and fretted. He was the same age as Rhodes, but somehow seemed younger. Like Rhodes, he was a bachelor who had no interest in women. He was by nature an adventurer and a gambler, who apparently without qualms gave up a successful medical practice in Kimberley and succumbed to the dreams of Rhodes. Everyone liked him, for he was a man with charm, and in Rhodes's cause he charmed nearly everyone. But he did not charm Paul Kruer. Jameson was sure that if he rode in, he could prod the reluctant Reform Committee into action, and all patience gone, he warned Rhodes, "Unless I hear definitely to the contrary, shall leave tomorrow morning." Rhodes's answer, "On no account must you move, I strongly object to such a course," never arrived, so Jameson mounted and rode over the border with 494 men, 8 Maxim machine guns, and 3 light field pieces. The Jameson raid was a fiasco from the beginning. The detail of troopers assigned to cut the telegraph line to the Transvaal got drunk and cut the line to Cape Town instead. Thus Rhodes did not know what was happening, but Kruer did. A Boer commando surrounded Jameson and his men about 10 miles outside Johannesburg, and on the morning of the 2nd of January 1896 they were forced to surrender. The Outlanders in Johannesburg had gone so far as to pass out a few of Rhodes's rifles, nothing more. They had no stomach for fighting. At the invitation of the Transvaal government, they sent a deputation to Pretoria, the capital. There, these shrewd Johannesburg businessmen proved themselves the most inept of revolutionaries, for when the Boer officials questioned their credentials and demanded to know whom they represented, they proudly handed over a complete list of the members of the Reform Committee and the other plotters. The Boers, list in hand, arrested them all. When Rhodes learned of the capture of Jameson, he told his friend W.P. Schreiner, Attorney General of Cape Colony, "Old Jameson has upset my apple cart. 20 years we have been friends, and now he goes in and ruins me." Rhodes was indeed ruined, but he kept his head and acted like a man, which is more than can be said for Joseph Chamberlain, the colonial secretary. Rhodes accepted the blame for his part in the affair, and in spite of heavy pressure to denounce Jameson, he refused to turn his back on him. As soon as the news of the Jameson raid reached Europe, the Germans began to rattle their sabres. The Kaiser sent a cruiser to Delagoa Bay, and when Jameson was captured, he telegraphed congratulations to Kruer on repelling the armed bands which invaded your country. This raised a storm of anti-German sentiment in England, and there was a music hall glorification of Jameson as a champion of England against what was regarded as German Boer intrigue. Still, as far as the British government was concerned, the raid was the cause of acute political embarrassment. "If filibustering fails," Lord Salisbury told Chamberlain, "it is always disreputable." As a result of the raid and the abortive revolt, some of Johannesburg's most substantial inhabitants were in jail, where they became one of the sights of the town, and were duly called on by distinguished visitors, including Mark Twain. Five of the conspirators were sentenced to death, including Colonel Frank Rhodes and John Hayes Hammond, a wealthy American mining engineer. Part of the beam of the gallows used by the British to hang the five rebels at Schlachter's Neck was brought out, and it was suggested that it would be appropriate to hang the conspirators from it. However, the British and American governments moved to save their people. Jamieson was eventually turned over to the British government for punishment, while the others were given heavy fines only. Both Jamieson and Rhodes were ordered to testify before a select committee of the House of Commons. When Jamieson gave his evidence, he said, "I know perfectly well that as I have not succeeded, the natural thing has happened, but I also know that if I had succeeded, I should have been forgiven." He was right, and everyone knew it. All Britain would have cheered, considering his action only a neat bit of needful skullduggery. There was much criticism of the Select Committee. Still, it resulted in Jamieson being sent to prison for a few months and Rhodes being strongly condemned. Its report stated, "Whatever justification there might have been for the action on the part of the people of Johannesburg, there was none for the conduct of a person in Mr. Rhodes' position." What was Rhodes's position? The difficulty was that he held too many positions. If Rhodes, as simply a wealthy man, had helped the Outlanders, this would have been understandable and excusable. If, as a director of the British South Africa Company, he had mobilised an armed force on the border in case of emergency, he might have been praised for his foresight. If, as Prime Minister of Cape Colony, he had, like Robinson and Chamberlain, simply closed his eyes to the planned revolt and failed to warn either his neighbour or his own government, this would have been overlooked. And if, as head of De Beers, he had permitted the company's resources to be used to further the aims of the revolutionists, it is doubtful if the shareholders would have protested. But doing all these things in all his capacities at the same time was too much. It was this which the Times called the unjustifiable character of Mr. Rhodes's action. Rhodes refused, in spite of his lawyer's entreaties, to implicate Chamberlain and the British government, as he could easily have done. In December 1896, his career was at its nadir. He had been forced to resign from all his public offices and to give up most of his directorships. His brother, through trying to help him, had lost his commission in the British Army and was in a Transvaal jail. His friend Jamieson was a convicted criminal. In addition, there was trouble in Rhodesia. The Mashona were in revolt, and his house at the Cape, Grote Skuur, which he loved, burned to the ground. He also suffered from ill health, malaria, influenza, and heart trouble. He had suffered a fall so great that he would never completely recover from it. Yet he woke up his friend Albert Gray one night and asked him if he had ever considered how fortunate he was to be an Englishman. The Jamieson raid had a profound effect upon the Boers. They were alarmed to discover that the Outlanders presented not only an internal threat but an external danger. War seemed again a possibility. Some of their gold, they decided, had best be spent for arms. Forts were constructed at Johannesburg, which the Outlanders believed were designed to control them, and expenditures for arms and equipment were increased fivefold. Most important of all was the purchase of modern Mauser rifles to replace their old Martini Henrys, and some of the finest artillery made in Europe. Kerr's handling of the Jamieson raid raised his prestige enormously. John Merriman said, "President Kerr now occupies without dispute the leading position in South Africa. His faults are forgotten in admiration of his success and the conviction that both in diplomacy and in war he is more than a match for the English." The raid also brought the two Boer republics closer together. As M.T. Stein, soon to be president of the Orange Free State, said, "After the Jamieson raid, it was clear to me that the fate of the Free State, whether we wished it or not, was tied up with that of the Transvaal, for better or for worse." And so the explosive powder of mutual distrust and enmity was prepared. So too was the port fire of Outlander discontent left smouldering. The man who put the fire to the powder and blew up South Africa was Alfred Milner, ably assisted by his superior, Joseph Chamberlain, and his opponent, Paul Kruger. 5. Moving towards war. It is the British race which built the empire, and it is the undivided British race which can alone uphold it. Deeper, stronger, more primordial than material ties, is the bond of common blood, a common language, common history and traditions. Such was the firm-seated belief of 43-year-old Sir Alfred Milner in 1897, on the eve of his departure from England to take up the posts of Governor of Cape Colony and High Commissioner for South Africa. He was an extraordinary man, Alfred Milner. Few felt indifferent towards him. He aroused intense hatred in some and the warmest admiration in others. Jan Smuts, after meeting him for the first time, told his wife that there is something in his very intelligent eyes that tells me he is a very dangerous man. He referred to himself as a civilian soldier of the Empire, and this he was. Yet many remarked on his un-British personality. He seemed more German than English, and his contempt for democratic processes. Sir Henry Campbell Bannerman, soon to be head of the Liberal Party, regarded him as an opinionated and dangerous man of doubtful judgment. As a boy, he had attended school in Germany, and at King's College London he proved to be a brilliant student, taking prizes in classics, history and literature, and at 18 winning the first scholarship at Balliol College, Oxford. There he won 4 successive scholarships, took a first class in Literae Humaniores, and was elected to a fellowship at New College. He has been described at this period as tall, dignified, and grave beyond his years, eager to organise rather than to influence, and fearful to give generous impulses full rein. He had already decided that marriage would interfere with a career, and that he would postpone it until he retired, a resolution which, like all his other resolutions, he kept. He refused a tutorship at New College, and went instead to London to study law, being called to the bar in 1881. Finding no success at the law, he turned to journalism and worked for the Pall Mall Gazette, floundering as do many promising young men looking for the right career. He ran for Parliament and was defeated. Then he accepted a position as secretary to George Goschen, who in 1886 became Chancellor of the Exchequer in Salisbury's ministry, and in this capacity he displayed such an extraordinary grasp of finance that in 1889 Goschen obtained for him the post of Director General of Accounts in Egypt. Here, for the first time, he prospered. 3 years later, Goschen brought him back to England to become chairman of the Board of Inland Revenue, and in another 3 years he was knighted, KCB. When Joseph Chamberlain offered Milner the posts of Governor of Cape Colony and High Commissioner for South Africa, Milner was delighted and told his friend R.B. Brett, later Viscount Esher, that, though I know perfectly well that I may break my neck over it, I am wild to go. On the 5th of May, 1897, this financial expert arrived in South Africa and went to work applying his genius to its very human problems. South Africa never recovered from the experience. His first 9 months in office were spent learning Dutch and Afrikaans, studying the local problems, and struggling, he said, against the temptation to say anything of substantial importance. Then, in a private letter to Chamberlain, dated the 23rd of February, 1898, he gave as his considered opinion that there is no way out of the political troubles in South Africa except reform in the Transvaal or war, and at present the chances of reform are worse than ever. To conclude that a country neighbouring a British colony must change its ways or Britain would have to go to war was a violent reaction to the situation existing in South Africa. To understand how Milner arrived at such an extraordinary conclusion, it is necessary to look beyond the facts and fantasies concerning the position of the Outlanders in the Transvaal to the set of attitudes which Milner brought with him to South Africa. To believe, as Milner did, that the British were natural rulers and that British rule was the best rule was a common enough belief among the British. Throughout the world, self-assured Englishmen ruled over people of other races and other cultures. To believe, as Milner did, that other races or people of other cultures ought not to rule over Englishmen, that it was not right that they should do so, that it was somehow morally wrong, This was a new conception of the imperial doctrine, a conception which, as such a situation had never before occurred, at least in modern history, had never before been examined. Milner now demanded that it be examined, and his own conclusion was already fixed. Englishmen must not be ruled by others. Although in an excellent position to promote his viewpoint, or rather to embody his attitude in policy and thus provoke war, Milner needed support of his chief. Joseph Chamberlain, 1836-1914, had been appointed colonial secretary only 6 months before the Jameson raid. In the 10 years he held the post, he was to give it an importance it had never before assumed and never would again. With his monocle ever screwed in his eye and an ever-present orchid on his lapel, he looked every inch an aristocrat, but in fact he came from a prosperous middle-class family of business people, and he himself had been a successful screw manufacturer before entering politics at the age of 38. He was thrice married. By one wife he had a son who became Prime Minister, and by another a son who became Chancellor of the Exchequer. He was called Pushful Joe and Imperial Joe, and of course a good many other less complimentary names. Sir Hercules Robinson considered him dangerous as an enemy, untrustworthy as a friend, but fatal as a colleague. Queen Victoria, however, thought him sensible, and he was immensely popular with jingoes, for he came to personify the imperial ideal. When he took office as colonial secretary, he claimed to have two important qualifications for the post. These qualifications are that, in the first place, I believe in the British race. I believe that the British race is the greatest of governing races that the world has ever seen, and I believe that there are no limits to its future. He was then a man after Milner's heart, but Chamberlain was, as Milner was not, a shrewd politician, aware of the political sensibilities of his countrymen. He also knew that it was he who would have to answer to his colleagues and to Parliament for Milner's actions. Chamberlain asked Milner to come home and explain his views. During Milner's absence from South Africa, his place was taken by Major General William Butler, 1838-1910, Commander-in-Chief of the British forces in South Africa. Butler was a curious specimen of Victorian soldiery. He had seen much active service in West Africa, Egypt, the Sudan, and Canada, where he had recommended the formation of the Northwest Mounted Police, and he had also served in Burma, India, and with Wolseley in South Africa. Like many Victorian officers, he loved war, and thought a battle by far the most exciting and enthralling of all life's possibilities to its mortals. Yet the only campaign in which he had taken part that he thought morally defensible was the Gordon Relief Expedition, and that was a failure. Although he had little formal education, he possessed a brilliant mind, and he was one of the most literate of the Victorian generals, the author of more than half a dozen books, and a friend of Victor Hugo. Butler was a man of strong opinions, and he was not hesitant in expressing them, even when they were unpopular. Of his lack of tact, General Evelyn Wood once said, "That he was generally right in his conclusions does not indicate that he always went the right way of obtaining them." Butler arrived in South Africa shortly after Milner left, and the two men did not have an opportunity to confer. Butler wrote later, "I went out blindfolded to South Africa in 1898. The bandages soon fell off." Like Milner, he carefully studied the problems he found, but he arrived at diametric conclusions. He believed that South Africa needed a rest cure and not an operation. He was undoubtedly right, but he also saw that, in spite of anything he might do, the surgeons would have their way. Never modest, he later wrote, "I was able to judge of a possible war between us and the Boers with a power of forecast of a quite exceptional character." What was there about the problems in South Africa that led men to consider such a drastic solution as war? Both sides wanted a united South Africa, though of course they differed in their ideas of who should dominate it. For the Boers, an Afrikaner South Africa seemed a distant aspiration. For the British, a united but British South Africa seemed not only desirable, but a possible and even necessary goal. There was much talk of the need to maintain British paramountcy, though no one was quite sure exactly what this meant or why it was necessary. It was with this idea in mind that the British had included the vague phrase about suzerainty in the preamble to the Pretoria Convention. It had been omitted from the London Convention, but with curious logic, the British now maintained that the preamble to the earlier document was assumed to be part of the later one. There was much official correspondence about this, and Milner noted that the word suzerainty had a curiously maddening effect on the Boers. The concept of an imperial mission, of the desirability, the nobility even, of one nation assuming suzerainty over another, or of one nation arrogating to itself a position of paramountcy in a part of the world containing other nations, is today an unpopular one. Yet it was commonly held prior to World War I. Englishmen believed in the white man's burden, in what was regarded as the heavy, thankless duty of civilized men to rule and teach all lesser, more inferior races. L.S. Amory espoused these ideals, but noted that not quite everyone felt this way, and that there existed a notion that nationalism is in itself a desirable thing, and that, apart from all question of political principle, it is, in some unexplained way, identical with political liberty. Little sympathy is bestowed on the great peoples rightly struggling for mastery, for the supremacy of higher civilization and higher principle. Lofty principles are often not formulated until after war has been declared, and so it was with the Anglo-Boer War. It was a week after hostilities had actually begun that Chamberlain told the House of Commons why Britain was fighting. "We are going to war in defence of principles, the principles on which this empire has been founded, and upon which alone it can exist. The first principle is this: if we are to maintain our existence as a great power in South Africa, we are bound to show that we are both willing and able to protect British subjects everywhere when they are made to suffer from oppression and injustice. The second principle is that in the interests of the British Empire, Great Britain must remain the paramount power in South Africa." So much for lofty principles. Some of the specific principles sound somewhat curious in relation to the grander ones. Chamberlain declared that Britain must protect British subjects everywhere, but to demand that British subjects be permitted to become citizens of a republic was a curious extension of the protection. The Outlander mine owners, known as Randlords, complained of corruption, and certainly this existed, although often it was the Randlords themselves who did the corrupting, and they particularly objected to a dynamite monopoly granted by the Transvaal government, which made it necessary for them to pay dearly for this needed article. Outlanders also complained of high taxes, and a bill to impose a modest 5% tax on mining profits was cited as an indication of how far the rights of arbitrary taxation might be carried. Today, the tax is computed on a complicated formula, but is close to 60%. They complained, too, that there were not enough English schools, and that the language of the laws and of the courts was the language of the country. All of these ills could be cured, they felt, if only they were given the franchise, the right to vote, and they were convinced of their right to demand it. The reluctance of the Boers to give the Outlanders the franchise was understandable. "For the little sheep, my door is always open," said Paul Kruger, "but the wolf I mean to keep out." But they were unsophisticated in their methods. Before 1882, only 1 year's residence had been required before an immigrant could become a citizen. Then the requirement was raised to 5 years. In 1890, fear of the Outlander vote caused the Volksrat to raise the residency requirement to 14 years, and the clamour grew. Outlanders ground out a continuous stream of complaints and did their best to turn minor incidents into models of oppression. Among the Outlanders, it was much resented that all public officials were Afrikaners, and it was particularly galling that the Boer policemen, called ZARPs, after the initials of the Zuid-Afrikaanse Republiek Politie, whom they considered corrupt and inefficient, should be permitted to arrest Englishmen. Of the provocative incidents which helped lead the way to war, none was more celebrated than the Edgar case, though it is difficult to see why. On the night of the 18th of December 1898, a powerfully built Englishman, Tom Edgar, fighting with another Englishman, beat him severely. The Zarps arrived and Edgar fled. The police pursued him to his home. There he resisted arrest, and in the scuffle he was shot and killed. As General Butler said, had this drunken brawl occurred in any other city in the world out of the Transvaal, it would have occasioned no excitement outside of the people immediately concerned in it. But the Outlanders at once seized the incident as an example of police brutality. Indignation meetings were called, a petition to the Queen was prepared, and dozens of letters and telegrams were dispatched to British politicians and officials. It somewhat detracted from the case as a propaganda vehicle that the policeman's name was Jones, but when his trial resulted in acquittal, it was hailed as an example of the lack of justice to be found in the Transvaal courts of law. Reporting the incident to London, Butler said, "I have no doubt that cases of rough usage by police have occurred in Johannesburg, but we must bear in mind that the town is probably the most corrupt, immoral, and untruthful assemblage of beings at present in the world." He was not the only one with such an unflattering opinion. J. A. Hobson, a keen observer of the scene there, wrote, "As for general liberty and even license of conduct, it existed nowhere if not in Johannesburg. Every luxury of life, every extravagance of behaviour, every form of private vice flourished unchecked. Every man and woman, except Kaffirs, who do the work and don't count, said and did what seemed good in his or her own eyes." Even Chamberlain characterised Johannesburgers as a lot of cowardly, selfish, blatant speculators who would sell their souls to have the power of rigging the market. The Jews of Johannesburg were flourishing, and in general did not join with other Outlanders in complaining to the government. But Butler suspected them of being at the root of the troublemaking, and in a dispatch to the War Office he wrote, "If the Jews were out of the question, it would be easy enough to come to an agreement, but they are apparently intent upon plunging the country into civil strife." This was also the view of Hilaire Belloc, who said that the war was openly and undeniably provoked and promoted by Jewish interests in South Africa. Jews had indeed flocked to the Transvaal from all parts of Europe. About half came from Germany or Central Europe, and Johannesburg boasted three synagogues. Many were poor but managed to establish themselves in businesses and trades, performing valuable functions outside the competence of the Boers in the urban life that sprang up in the boom town that was Johannesburg. Few, however, took any part in the agitation or signed their names to the many complaints sent to the British High Commissioner. Those from Central Europe, it was thought amusing by the Outlanders to call these Peruvians, had never enjoyed any political rights in their home countries, and they found the Boers' almost complete lack of anti-Semitism refreshing. Some even sent declarations of support to Kruger, disassociating themselves from the clamouring of the other Outlanders. Milner was not completely successful in England. In spite of his best efforts, he had not entirely convinced Chamberlain and his colleagues that war was inevitable. On the 8th of May, 1896, Chamberlain had told the House of Commons, "A war in South Africa would be one of the most serious wars that could possibly be waged. It would be in the nature of a civil war. It would be a long war and a costly war, and, as I have pointed out already, it would leave behind it the embers of a strife which I believe generations would be hardly long enough to extinguish." He was, of course, absolutely right, and it was unfortunate that 3 years later Milner was able to persuade him to change his views. Chamberlain, sympathetic to Milner's views but afraid that the British public was not yet prepared for war, asked him to sum up the situation and his views in a dispatch which might be made public. Milner did so in a long telegram which L.S. Amery called one of the most masterly state documents ever penned. It became famous as the Helots Dispatch. It seems a paradox, but it is true, that the only effective way of protecting our subjects is to help them to cease to be our subjects. It is idle to talk of peace and unity. The case for intervention is overwhelming. The spectacle of thousands of British subjects kept permanently in the position of helots constantly chafing under undoubted grievances and calling vainly to Her Majesty's government for redress, does steadily undermine the influence and reputation of Great Britain and the respect for the British government within its own dominions. The Helot's dispatch reached Chamberlain on the 5th of May 1899, but it was not immediately released. M.T. Stein, President of the Orange Free State, and William P. Schreiner, Prime Minister of Cape Colony, proposed that Milner and Kruger meet face to face at Bloemfontein, the Free State capital. Chamberlain thought this an excellent idea. Milner was less enthusiastic, but could hardly refuse. He had no skill in diplomacy, or at least no taste for it. Just before leaving Cape Town for Bloemfontein, he wrote, "My view has been, and still is, that if we are perfectly determined, we shall win without a fight, or with a mere apology for one." The conference lasted only from the 31st of May until the 5th of June. Facing Milner across the table was Paul Kruger, described by Henry M. Stanley, who had met him a few months before, as a Boer Machiavelli, astute and bigoted, obstinate as a mule, remarkably opinionated, vain and puffed up with the power conferred on him, vindictive, covetous, and always a Boer, which means a narrow-minded and obtuse provincial of the illiterate type, and by Kipling as sloven, sullen, savage, secret, uncontrolled, and cruel in the shadow, crafty in the sun. But these were British opinions. To his own people he was a strong, resourceful leader. Cunning, obstinate and uneducated, yes, but wise in the ways of his own folk and sensitive to their needs and aspirations. Stephanus Johannes Paulus Kruger, 1825-1904, to give him his full and correct name, exhibited most of the strengths and weaknesses of his race in bold relief. Born on a farm near Venterstadt in Cape Colony, he had been taken by his parents on the Great Trek, and by the time he was 21 had seen action against the Bantu, had twice married, his first wife died young, and had settled on his own farm near Rustenburg in the Transvaal. He was a deeply religious man, a member of the Dopper sect of the Dutch Reformed Church. The strictest of Calvinists, Doppers interpreted the Bible so literally that Kruger once assured Captain Joshua Slocum, the American circumnavigator, that the world was flat. He read nothing but the Bible, not even a newspaper. The words of the Old Testament were constantly on his lips, and all of his life he served as a lay preacher. He had had only 3 months of schooling, and he wrote with difficulty, even forming his signature laboriously. But his mind was quick, he was shrewd, and he had a remarkable memory. In the wars against the Bantu, he had earned a reputation for bravery. In the internal squabbles of the early Trekker republics, he became renowned for his astuteness. When in 1883, at the age of 58, he was first elected president of the Transvaal, he continued to live as he always had. He rose each morning at dawn, read his Bible, and then held a religious service for his family. He had 7 daughters and 9 sons. After that, he sat on the front stoop of his unpretentious house in Pretoria, drinking innumerable cups of coffee, his pipe ever in his mouth, and conducted the business of the state. His people also came to him here with their agricultural and domestic problems, for he was considered wise in these matters. Gesina, his wife, kept cows and chickens, thriftily sold milk and eggs to her neighbours, and freely dispensed her great supply of home remedies for all diseases. Kruger was a huge man with an enormous head that carried one of the world's ugliest faces. His left thumb was gone, torn off when, as a young man, his gun exploded as he was shooting a rhinoceros. Stanley said that he spoke in a voice that was like a loud gurgle, as the great jaws and cheeks heaved and opened. His speeches sounded like sermons. He often had a surly manner, and to some he seemed uncouth, but he had a kind of gnarled grandeur, and he impressed men with his rhetoric and by his resourcefulness and strength of will. When the conference began, Kruger tried to bargain, but Milner was obdurate. He had been instructed by Chamberlain to lay all stress on the question of the franchise, and this he did by simply stating his terms, 5 years residency, and refusing to budge. Kruger told him, I understand from His Excellency's arguments that if I do not give the whole management of my land and government to strangers, there is nothing to be done. I am not ready to hand over my country to strangers. Milner simply sat, cold, impassive, insistent. President Stein did everything in his power to keep the conference going and to prevent a deadlock. Kruger offered to ask the Volksrat to reduce the residency requirement from 14 years to 7. To Stein this seemed a major concession, and he had a private talk with Milner in an attempt to persuade him to accept this and take up other issues, the teaching of English in the schools, and customs, postal and railway unions. But Milner was so uncompromising that Stein despaired. When he left the meeting, he went directly to his office, where he sat down and ordered 2,000 Mauser rifles and 1,000,000 rounds of ammunition. He was too late. War began before the arms arrived. Chamberlain, too, was anxious for the talks to continue, and he cabled Milner that it was of the utmost importance to put the President of the South African Republic clearly in the wrong. But the impatient Milner had already slammed the door and closed the conference. Kruger summed it up simply. It is my country you want. As he drove away, there were tears streaming down his rutted, homely face. Although undoubtedly disheartened, Kruger did not cease his efforts to keep his country from plunging into war. As he told Milner he would, he went home and persuaded his Volksrat to reduce the residency requirement to 7 years. 7 years was not as good as 5, but it was not worth going to war for the extra 2 years. In Britain there were sighs of relief. The Times announced that the crisis was over. No, 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 cried Milner. There were other aspects of the case. The conditions were not as good as they appeared. The real issue was not the franchise after all, but British paramountcy in South Africa. Speaking of the new franchise law in a dispatch, Milner said that if it is enforced rigidly, there will be practically unlimited opportunities of excluding persons whom the government considers undesirable. Why a country should not be allowed to exclude undesirable foreigners was not explained. He now proposed a joint inquiry into Transvaal reforms. Chamberlain, following Milner's lead, decided to ignore the Transvaal's conciliatory gestures and released Milner's Helots dispatch. The British public, even the cabinet, had shown little interest in South Africa, but the dramatic dispatch created a sensation, and not just in Britain. The British in South Africa reacted as well. Throughout the winter months in South Africa, June, July and August, there were anti-Boer demonstrations, public meetings, petitions and incidents of all kinds, not only in the Transvaal, but in Natal and Cape Colony as well. On the 26th of June, Chamberlain gave a bellicose speech in Birmingham, in which he said, "We have tried waiting, patience, and trusting to promises which were never kept. We can wait no more. It is our duty, not only to the Outlander, but to the English throughout South Africa, to the native races, and to our own prestige in that part of the world, and to the world at large, to insist that the Transvaal falls into line with the other states in South Africa, and no longer menaces the peace and prosperity of the world." Difficult as it may have been to see how the Transvaal was menacing the peace of the world, Chamberlain had now thrown down the gauntlet, not only to the Boers, but politically to his party, and particularly to his colleagues in the cabinet. They had either to go along with him or to disown him. Since he was too powerful a political figure to be dismissed, the cabinet reluctantly supported him. Balfour grumbled to Salisbury about Chamberlain's favourite method of dealing with the South African sore, by the free application of irritants. But when Chamberlain asked for troops, he reluctantly agreed that they should be sent. "I cannot think it wise to allow him to goad on the Boers by his speeches, and to refuse him the means of repelling Boer attack." Lord Salisbury, the Prime Minister, in a letter to Lord Lansdowne, the Secretary for War, spoke of the Outlanders as a people we despise, who were living in territory which will bring no profit and no power to England. The cabinet, he complained, was committed to act upon a moral field prepared for us by Milner and his Jingo supporters. While Chamberlain and his supporters were preparing Britain for war, frantic efforts were being made in Pretoria to prevent it. In mid-August, Jan Smuts, the 29-year-old state attorney of the Transvaal, met secretly with W. Conyngham Green, British agent in Pretoria, to work out new proposals. The result was an agreement on the part of the Transvaal to a 5-year residency for the franchise, if only Britain would agree not to interfere in future with the domestic problems of the country, and to submit points in dispute to arbitration by third parties. On the 28th of August, Chamberlain gave what he called a qualified acceptance to the agreement, but which was, in fact, a complete rejection. He had gone too far now to turn back. At a garden party, he made a speech in which he referred to the Transvaal dribbling out reforms like a squeezed sponge. Milner, worried that the Transvaal might agree to all his terms, suggested to Chamberlain that Britain should now demand that the Transvaal disarm, a condition they certainly would not accept. This at the moment seemed too crude for Chamberlain, although he told Milner, "I dread above all the whittling away of differences until we have no casus belli left." Chamberlain had no cause to worry. On the 8th of September, he sent a telegram to South Africa, stating that it was the unanimous decision of the cabinet to repudiate the claims of the Transvaal to be a sovereign international state, and that Britain would not consider any proposal which appeared to acknowledge such claims. That did it. On the same date, the cabinet ordered an increase in the number of troops in South Africa to 22,000. Incredibly, although Milner and Chamberlain had been relentlessly pursuing a policy which they and all the leaders of the government saw would probably lead to war, almost no provision whatever had been made to fight a war in South Africa. It was not until June that the Cape Command was even ordered to collect regimental transport. Milner constantly urged Butler to prepare for war, but Butler had received no orders from the War Office, and so had done nothing. He was later much criticised for this. A British South African named Aubrey Wools Sampson, who had been one of the staunchest members of the Reform Committee, devised a scheme for raising a volunteer force, but Butler objected, saying that raising such a force would only alarm the Boers still more and increase the tension. He refused to sanction it, and Milner said to him bitterly, "It can never be said, Sir William, that you precipitated a conflict with the Dutch." Indeed, it could not. During his brief period as acting High Commissioner while Milner was in England, Butler had done everything he could to dampen the rising flames of Outlander discontent, and all that he had done had met with Milner's disapproval. When Milner returned and Butler reverted to his position as Commander-in-Chief, the old general tried to hold his tongue as he watched Milner pursue his provocative diplomacy, but tongue-holding was not easy for him. In his dispatches home, Milner complained constantly of Butler and his policy of obstructive pacifism. On the 14th of June, he wrote to Chamberlain, "The general, he is too awful. He has, I believe, made his military preparations all right, but I cannot get him to make the least move or take the slightest interest. He will wait for his WO orders, but till he has commands to mobilise, he will not budge an inch. His sympathy is wholly with the other side. At the same time, there is nothing to lay hold of. He never interferes with my business and is perfectly polite, but he is absolutely no use." It was a curious situation. A diplomatist doing his best to start a war and a general doing his best to prevent it. Milner cast about desperately for an excuse to get rid of this pacifist general. When the War Office sent Butler an order to purchase mules, asked some questions concerning supplies, and concluded by asking if he had any observations, Butler seized this as an excuse to air his opinion on the political situation. "I believe war between the white races would be the greatest calamity that ever occurred in South Africa." The War Office rebuked him, saying that political observations had not been requested. Milner wrote to Chamberlain, "I am sorry to say that in my opinion the strength of the General's political opinion impairs his efficiency, whatever his military capacity." He asked for Butler's recall. Butler was forced to resign, and his resignation was accepted on the 9th of August 1899, scarcely more than a month before the beginning of the war. As Viscount Isher later told King Edward VII, Sir William met the fate of those who give unpalatable advice. That much of the advice he gave has since proved correct is not possibly of advantage to him in certain quarters.
6. Eve of War.
The stage was now set for war. Boers and Britons were psychologically prepared for it. All had been driven to the proper state of exasperation by the futile meetings, the legal technicalities, the endless correspondence. Most men were now impatient for the talk to end and the action to begin. The Boers were maddened by Milner's intransigence and outraged by the threat to their cherished independence. The British were swept by a tremendous surge of imperial sentiment such as they had never before experienced. Practical considerations on both sides delayed the start of hostilities for a few weeks. Britain waited for reinforcements to arrive in South Africa. The Boers waited for the spring grass to cover the veldt, grass to sustain the horses and ponies of their commandos. Both sides expected the war to be short. The Boers thought that Britain would be unwilling to accept the cost in lives and treasure necessary to subdue them, and that she would, as in 1881, back off. They underestimated the determination of the British to see the thing through this time, to conquer them once and for all. The Boers had a misplaced confidence in the intervention of European powers on their behalf if the war should last longer than a few months. The British had an ill-founded confidence in the efficacy of their army, and they underestimated both the military capacities of the Boers and their determination to resist. There were still some futile diplomatic gestures in the few weeks before the hostilities began. Just as on the British side it had been the Commander-in-Chief in South Africa, General Butler, who had striven for peace, so among the Boers it was the Commandant-General, Piet Joubert, hero of Majuba, who tried at the last minute to stave off the war. He wrote a long missive to Queen Victoria, entitled "An Earnest Representation and Historical Reminder to Her Majesty, in view of the prevailing crisis." He sent copies to the Kaiser and the Tsar. The Queen of the Netherlands also wrote to Queen Victoria, pleading with her to use her influence to prevent war in South Africa. But Queen Victoria replied, "If President Kruger is reasonable, there will be no war, but the issue is in his hands." No one had worked harder to preserve the peace than Martinus Ternis Stein, 1857 to 1916, who knew that when Britain went to war with the Transvaal, his own country would inevitably become involved, not only because of the mutual defence pact between the two republics, but also because of the sentiments of his own people, and the certainty that if the Transvaal fell, the Orange Free State could not long survive as a republican island surrounded by British colonies. He wrote an urgent plea for peace and asked Milner to send it to London. Milner reluctantly agreed to relay it, then, without Stein's knowledge, he cut out portions of the message because of its enormous length. Stein also sent off a message to President William McKinley, pleading for American intervention. But the United States had just concluded an imperialistic war of its own, in which it had acquired the Philippines. And since the Filipinos liked the Yankees no better than they had liked the Spaniards and wanted their freedom, the Americans were occupied in suppressing them. Besides, Britain had sided with the United States in the war with Spain and had in many little ways been helpful. The South African republics were not likely to find help in this quarter. On the 17th of June 1899, Sir Henry Campbell Bannerman, ingenuously looking only at the facts, declared that there was nothing in the South African situation to justify preparing for war. But as John Adams had said more than a century before, a torrent is not to be impeded by reasoning. The lust for war is not to be controlled by logic, nor its gratification deterred by facts. The War Office apparently agreed with Campbell Bannerman, and despite repeated warnings from Lord Wolseley, the Commander-in-Chief, continued to turn a blind eye and a deaf ear to what was going on in the nation, and declined to bestir itself sufficiently to prepare for a major conflict. No plan for a campaign in South Africa existed. In June, the British had only about 10,000 regulars and 24 field guns in all South Africa. On the 8th of June, Lord Wolseley recommended the mobilisation in England of an army corps and a cavalry division, under the command of a general who would take it to South Africa if needed. However, as a royal commission discovered after the war, this was never seriously entertained by the government. 2 weeks later, two officers were sent to South Africa to buy 1,340 animals, less than 1% of the number which would actually be required. But the Secretary of State for War refused to authorise remount buyers to be sent to Italy and Spain. While Milner was stirring the pot and keeping it boiling in South Africa, the generals were growing uneasy, and General Sir Redvers Buller, who had been selected to take an army to South Africa should it be required, wrote direct to the Prime Minister, telling Salisbury that, before the diplomatist proceeds to an ultimatum, the military should be in a position to enforce it. So far as I am aware, the War Office has no idea of how matters are proceeding and has not been consulted. On the same day, the 5th of September, Wolseley wrote in a minute, "The government are acting without complete knowledge of what the military can do, while the military authorities are equally without full knowledge of what the government expects them to do, nor are they given authority to make such antecedent preparations as will enable them to act with the least possible delay." On the 16th of September, with war less than a month away, Milner sent a request for speedy reinforcements of troops and men of war. Only then did the government agree to send out reinforcements from India and to order Lieutenant General Sir George White, VC, out from England to take command in Natal. By the time hostilities actually began, the British had mustered only about 22,000 men and 60 guns in South Africa. More than a quarter of the men had been locally recruited and were largely untrained. Just over half of these were stationed in Natal. The British Army, as was soon to be revealed, was not adequate to the strain which was about to be put upon it. The Empire had grown enormous and at a rapid rate. While the army, too, had expanded, it had, through no fault of its own, not grown large enough to handle all of the wide-flung commitments expected of it and to fight a major war at the same time. On paper, at least, there were 249,466 regulars and about 90,000 reservists, but only 70,000 were available for service in South Africa, even including those intended for home defence. In spite of this shortage of soldiers, the government made a decision which deliberately deprived the army of one of its greatest sources of trained manpower. It was decided that the war in South Africa was to be a white man's war. The experienced Indian army would not be used, and the Bantu and other coloured races in South Africa would not be formed into combat units or employed as local levies. As L.S. Amery put it in The Times History, "It was held inadvisable to make use of any but white soldiers in a war fought between white men in a country where the black man presents so difficult a problem." The Boers had similar views, so the white men on both sides warned the Basutos, Zulus, Swazis and other Bantu to stay out of their war. However, if the war was to be fought exclusively by white men, Britain would have to find more. There was no lack of volunteers. Even before the war began, in July and August, the Australian colonies and New Zealand offered to send men, and the day after war was declared, Canada offered 1,000 volunteers. Offers of men to fight the war came from all corners of the globe. Indian princes offered men, horses and material. The Malay states wanted to send 300 Malay States Guards, the governor of Lagos 300 Hausas, and small groups of Englishmen everywhere proposed to rush to the Empire's aid. The military authorities were cool to these offers. Colonials, they felt, would be difficult to manage and probably troublesome. Nevertheless, it was thought to be a generous gesture, and it seemed politically wise to allow the white colonies, as a favour, to participate in the war. Pressure was put on the War Office, and on the 3rd of October the colonies were told by telegraph that they could contribute some volunteers, but in view of the numbers already available, infantry most, cavalry least serviceable. This telegram was much cited, usually misquoted in the form of "dismounted men preferred," as evidence of how little the generals knew about the nature of the war they were to fight. Before the war was over, some 25,000 Australians, New Zealanders and Canadians were gratefully accepted. All independent, queer and odd, but most amazing new, Kipling wrote. And so they must have seemed to the British regular, for the army he lived in was a closed little world of its own. British officers formed an almost separate caste. Most were the sons of officers, civil servants, Anglican clergymen, squires or professional men. Few were the sons of businessmen, and fewer still were the sons of artisans or labourers. The common soldiers were drawn from the lowest classes. More than two-thirds were poor Scots and Irish. Many were illiterate. From Irish bogs and Glasgow slums, they turned to the army as the only escape from starvation and dulling poverty. Officers did not expect much of them. Lieutenant Colonel Forbes McBean, who became commanding officer of the Gordon Highlanders, described his recruits. It is natural not to expect much in the way of individual intelligence, either from the recruit who comes from the part of the population which is poorest, worst fed from infancy, least educated and brought up largely in crowded towns, or from the recruit who, though a country lad, is not naturally a man gifted with intelligence. Unlike the Boers, who enrolled boys and old men, the British infantrymen and cavalrymen, initially sent to South Africa, were all at least 20 years old with 1 year's service. Artillerymen had to be 19 years old with 9 months' service. Officers excepted, there were few soldiers in South Africa over 35. Most were between 20 and 30. It was easier for the British to find the men than the necessary supplies. Economy had ever been in the minds of the members of Parliament when examining the military estimates. The nation was now to pay dearly for it. After the failure of the Bloemfontein Conference, Wolseley had recommended that stores, ordnance and transport be accumulated in South Africa, but the Cabinet had rejected the idea. Now, 3 months later, with war almost upon them, the army found itself woefully unprepared. In the army depots there were only scarlet and blue uniforms, none of the new khaki adopted for field service in the Sudan campaign of 1898. There were no reserves of horses, saddles or horseshoes. The rifles in the reserve all had defective sights, and there were only 80 cavalry swords to spare. Worst of all, the supplies of ammunition were inadequate. There were only 200 rounds per gun for the horse, field and mountain batteries. Of 151 million rounds of rifle ammunition in stock, 66 million were Mark IV, commonly called dum-dums, bullets with a slightly cylindrical cavity at their head covered by a hard envelope which expanded on contact and created dreadful wounds. The first peace conference, held at The Hague, had just ended on the 12th of July, and 26 nations, including Britain, had agreed that dum-dums were too barbarous to use. How many were actually fired during the war in South Africa is unknown, but both sides indignantly accused the other of using them, and there is ample and reliable evidence that both sides did. Not only was there a shortage of everything that would be needed to wage war, but no one at the War Office thought to alert armaments manufacturers until sometime in October that they might expect increased demands on their facilities. In other words, not until a few days before, or perhaps after, the war began. Either the makers of arms, ammunition and other war supplies did not think there would be a war, or if they did, it appears not to have occurred to them that war would create an increased need for their products. They were in any case as unprepared for war as was the army. Even more serious than the shortage of men and supplies was the fact that the army was neither organised nor trained to fight a major war against an enemy armed with modern weapons. There was no general staff. The mobilisation plan was crude. None of the units later thrown together into brigades and divisions had ever worked as a unit. The regular army, militia, yeomanry, volunteers and colonial forces had no organic connection with each other. Ammunition and money had been saved by trimming musketry training, and the result was that British soldiers could march better than they could shoot. Mounted troops were given no musketry training at all, although they were issued carbines. Money had been saved as well by skimping on the intelligence department. Considered not a very important unit, It worked out of an old house in Queen Anne's Gate on a budget of £18,000. This at a time when the German Army's intelligence unit operated with a budget of £270,000 and a staff that included 300 officers. At Queen Anne's Gate, the entire foreign intelligence section, including clerks, numbered 14. The mapping section numbered only 30 persons, versus 230 in the French Army's equivalent, and the lack of maps of South Africa was to prove a costly economy. In spite of these handicaps, the intelligence department did collect some valuable information, but almost none was passed on to those who were to command in South Africa. General F. W. Forstier Walker, Butler's replacement, who arrived in South Africa just 5 weeks before the shooting started, later complained that he had received no instructions from the War Office other than to take command. As to the actual state of affairs and the imminence of war, practically nothing was known beyond the reports which appeared in the daily press. Sir George White left England to take command of the forces in Natal on the 16th of September, less than 30 days before war was declared, yet neither the military authorities nor any of the politicians explained the situation to him, outlined British policy, or discussed possible strategies. He did not think of talking with military intelligence, nor did anyone suggest it. The Boers were almost as ignorant of the British army as the British were of theirs, and they had given as little thought to their war plan. However, they began the war with a number of distinct advantages. They were familiar with the country, they had interior lines of supply and communication, their forces in the theatre of operations outnumbered the British, they possessed superior weapons, their organisational structure was simpler and better suited to the type of war they would have to fight, and their fighting men knew how to ride and shoot. The Boer armies of the Transvaal and the Orange Free State, numbering between 50 and 60,000, although it is doubtful if more than 40,000 were ever in the field at one time, consisted simply of every able-bodied male between the ages of 16 and 60, and there were many above and below those ages who also served. Except for the small numbers in the police force, some units of which fought in the army, and the artillery, it was an army without uniforms, medals, bands, insignia of rank, or pay. There were none of the trappings usually considered necessary to encourage men to become soldiers, and there were none of the rules and regulations usually considered necessary to turn men into fighting machines. There was no marching, drilling, or saluting, and no formal training. In each electoral district, 18 in the Orange Free State and 22 in the Transvaal, there were from 2 to 6 vikes, or wards, under an elected field cornet. The men of each district formed a commando of indeterminate size under a commandant, also elected. Some of the larger field cornetcies were broken down into corporalships, or sexies, sections. Each republic had an elected head of its army, a commandant general in the Transvaal and a commandant in chief in the Free State, and later there were lesser ranks of generals, assistant commandant generals and vecht, fighting generals. Mobilisation was a simple matter. The field cornet in each vijk called up the local burghers, and they assembled in a nearby town or on a convenient farm, each man with his horse, bridle, saddle, rifle, 30 or more cartridges, and 8 days' provisions. They were then ready to move and to fight. An exception to the undisciplined, slouching horsemen in the commandos was the Staatsartillerie, state's artillery. This was in both republics well organised, disciplined, and trained by officers who had served in the German army. They wore German-style uniforms, and on parade they marched with the goose step. These few uniformed artillerymen, about 400 in the Orange Free State and 800 in the Transvaal, were in striking contrast to the rest of the Boer army, who went to war clothed in whatever each man deemed appropriate. Many from the towns wore business suits and neckties. Some of the older men, particularly officers, wore high-crowned hats and frock coats with claw-hammer tails. But the most characteristic attire was marked by a broad-brimmed hat, corduroy pants, and a bandolier of ammunition slung over the shoulder. The only item of equipment which the Boer governments provided was the Mauser rifle. Like the British Lee Metford and Lee Enfield, The Mauser had a 5-cartridge magazine, but there was an important difference. The magazine of the British rifles had to be loaded 1 cartridge at a time, and the soldiers carried their bullets loose in ammunition pouches. The Boers carried their cartridges in clips, and a 5-round clip could be inserted quickly by a push of the thumb. Thus, while a British soldier could fire 5 rounds as fast as a Boer, the latter could fire 50 rounds faster than the soldier could fire 20 because of the speed at which he could reload. The Mauser also had fine and exact sights, and it could kill at 2,200 yards. It was then altogether a better weapon than the British rifle. In this rifleman's war, the superiority of the quick-firing Mausers made an immense difference on the battlefield, and the British were soon made aware of it. But in the course of the war, no improvements were made in their rifles. No one suggested buying better ones, or even using captured Mausers. The laws provided penalties for failure to heed the summons to join a commando when called, and for desertion. But in actual fact, these penalties were rarely imposed. If a man did not like his field cornet or commandant, he simply left his unit and joined another. A burgher was supposed to obtain permission from his officers to go on leave, but frequently when a man's wife or his cow took sick, or he himself became homesick, he simply left the war and went home. This unauthorised leave-taking was the bane of every Boer general's existence. There were military advantages to this independence. Accustomed to thinking for himself, the Boer was capable of acting in emergencies without waiting for orders. The officers knew that the men with them were highly motivated and trusted them. Battle plans were agreed upon at Kriegsrats, and each man knew the plan and could act independently to carry it out. Captain Alfred Thayer Mahan, the American naval officer and historian, noted, "Every Boer organisation seems susceptible of immediate dissolution into its component units, each of independent vitality, and of subsequent reunion in some assigned place." The British found this disconcerting. Sir Redvers Buller was to complain that Boer units were like those living organisms which can be cut apart without destroying the individual life of the fragments. Every Boer rode a horse, and with the exception of the Staatsartillerie, the entire Boer force consisted of what was essentially mounted infantry. From early childhood, most of the men had been raised with horses and oxen. They understood their management. Unlike the British soldiers, they knew how to take care of themselves on the veldt, and how to take advantage of its terrain. Many of the British soldiers, officers and men found it difficult to estimate distances in the clear air of the high veldt, and this affected their sighting. This was the natural element of the Boer, and he was very good at judging distances. He was familiar with the veldt's bushes, anthills and kopjes. From his experiences in hunting and fighting Bantu, he knew how to take advantage of cover, both for offence and for defence. To his opponents, coming from the cities and towns of Britain, and even to British farm lads, the veldt was strange, its kopjes different from the hills with which they were familiar, its flora and fauna alien and exotic. The Orange Free State still had some outmoded cannon, but the Staatsartillerie of the Transvaal was equipped with 60 or 70 modern guns of the latest design. From France, the Transvaal government had bought 75mm and 155mm Creusot guns, equipped with recoil mechanisms. The latter came to be known as long toms. From Germany, they purchased 120mm Krupp howitzers. And from England, yes, England, 22 or 23 37mm Vickers Maxim automatic quick-firing guns, called pom-poms from the sound they made, which fired a belt of 10 one-pound shells at a rate of 1 every 2 seconds and had a range of about 4,000 yards. The pom-pom had been designed for naval use, but the Boers thought it would be a handy weapon on the veldt, as indeed it was. All of these guns used smokeless powder, which made them difficult to locate. Seeing how valuable a weapon the pom-pom was in the hands of their enemy, the Royal Artillery finally ordered some for themselves. Both sides used machine guns, mostly 303-inch calibre Maxims, although their proper employment was not understood. They were mounted on carts, and men could not seem to make up their minds whether they were infantry weapons or artillery pieces. It is curious that neither side used mortars. This uncomplicated weapon was known to earlier generations of soldiers, and a lightweight mortar would have been most useful and practical, but apparently no one ever thought of it. Hand grenades were not used either, except for some homemade varieties. Both the telephone and the telegraph existed in 1899. Johannesburg had a telephone exchange in 1895. But their use on the battlefield was limited, commanders not understanding their full potentiality. Before the war was over, a wireless message had crossed the Atlantic, but none crossed the veldt. Observation balloons made of goldbeater skin were employed by the British, but there is no evidence that a commanding officer ever went up in one, and often they were not sent up when they would have been most useful. It does not appear that anyone ever thought of equipping.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.